Good afternoon to you. I hope you and your family are doing well. Pastor Stecker here with Grace Lutheran Church here in Nashua, New Hampshire, as we continue our Bible study here on Paul the Apostle. Today is chapter 7. We're calling it The Standoff. It's the story of Paul in Antioch and his relationships with the church in Jerusalem. Happy Tuesday. We have now worked through some of the theological foundations that motivated Paul and Barnabas as they set off on their missionary journeys. They were motivated by this new creation, which had been established through Jesus' life, death, and resurrection. And as previously noted, they were watching the Spirit work in these Christian communities made up of both Jew and Gentile. The one true living God was at work, but as with most things, there were going to be some hurdles to jump. Last week, we focused in part on the hurdle that was to be jumped in the Gentile communities. Paul was proclaiming a reality which drastically challenged everything that the pagan communities stood for. It was, however, an offering which opened the door into a whole new rebirth, a life in community with the one true, personal, and loving God. And as these Gentiles converted, being grafted in or brought into the Christian communities who rightly worship the one true God of the Jewish scriptures, there was now a new challenge being faced from the Jewish perspective, particularly in the church in Jerusalem. It's imperative that we properly understand the debate and the struggle that was going on. Once again, we often paint modern ideals back into the stories taking place. Paul was certainly preaching a new social reality, Jews and Gentiles being brought together into one kingdom, one where circumcision was not necessary. And this challenged the regular Jewish taboos. But as Wright says, this wasn't because Paul had suddenly invented the 18th century ideal of tolerance, but because Paul believed that a whole new world order was happening through the Messiah people, those who were heirs to the kingdom which Jesus had launched. This was a radical new message, but once again, it was not a new religion. Rather, it was a radical explanation about a chain of events that shed light back on Israel's history and the scriptures themselves. However, this wasn't something that was instantly grasped. This new message wasn't simple, and so there were some challenging conversations that needed to take place in the early church. And interestingly, understanding the real scope of these conversations helps us avoid pitfalls and stern misinterpretations in our own day. So first, let's unpack the reservations from the Jewish Christians in Jerusalem. Today we are unpacking the standoff that takes place between Peter and Paul, the standoff about whether Gentiles needed to be circumcised in order to be brought into the Christian church. And understanding this disagreement is paramount to understanding both Paul's theology, especially in his letter to Galatians, and the theology that is foundational to our Christian beliefs. So first, let's unpack again the cultural circumstances that would lead to Peter and some other Christians' suspicion of Paul and his mission in these Gentile-heavy regions. The first thing for us to understand is the expectations of the Jewish people. As we've talked about before, they were anxiously awaiting the liberation of the Jewish people from the hands of the pagans, particularly the hands of the Romans in the first century. This was something which had long been prophesied, and the primary job of the Jew was to stay loyal to God, avoiding the temptations of falling into the false worship and moral practices of the pagans around them. And to help them do this, they relied heavily on following the laws of the Torah, which is the first five books of the Old Testament. Paramount to this was the practice of circumcision, which set all Jewish men apart from the Gentiles around them. It's important to note that they were absolutely right in trying to follow the Torah. There's no discussion on whether or not they were supposed to be circumcising their male children and to be living a different moral and worship life than the Gentiles. We as Christians do not by any means believe that Jesus came teaching a laxed or more lenient moral vision. But we do believe that Jesus came and fulfilled something. And this was Paul's message. Not that the moral or religious rules had become irrelevant, but that some things, such as circumcision, were no longer necessary. And that the entire law was made perfect not in us, but in Christ. Now we'll get to more of this in a few minutes. Now to summarize the current position of the Christian church in Jerusalem. They believed that the Gentiles were allowed to be brought into the Christian church. They could be grafted in, they could be brought into the covenantal relationship. This was something that had been accomplished through Jesus' life, death, and resurrection. They believed this. However, they also believed that those Gentiles who were grafted in were now supposed to abide by the previous covenantal guidelines. This included dietary laws, the moral laws, the worship practices, and male circumcision. In other words, they were being allowed into the Jewish life, culture, and worship life. Now, let's recap this before moving on. In Israel, the people were part of a covenantal relationship with Yahweh. And Yahweh had set up some rules and regulations for them to follow. Among many reasons for this was to keep the Jews from rejecting God and joining the wicked and false practices of the Gentile nations. Almost all of Israel's historical problems were results of them not following God's guidelines and instead giving in and joining the Gentiles in their wicked practices. So now this large group of first century Christians in Jerusalem were proclaiming and confessing that this Jesus was God's Messiah who had finally delivered Israel from its sins and established the kingdom which was foretold of, where Jesus, risen from the dead and ascended into heaven, was the king and leader. And that the Gentiles were also given the forgiveness of sins and the opportunity to join in the community. However, with everything we just said being correct, there was now a debate on what the bringing in of the Gentiles meant. The issue was that Paul was saying that some things such as circumcision were not needed. The leaders in Jerusalem, particularly James, was saying that the circumcision was still needed. Now, why the disagreement? We'll unpack that here in a few minutes. But for now, there are a few important things that we can rule out. We will soon talk about some of the historical situations that arise from this, such as Peter's visit to Antioch and eventually his submission that Paul's approach is right. But before we do this, we need to hash out some common misconceptions on what this argument is really about. Paul is going to speak about how Christians are going to be marked not by circumcision, but by pistis, or faith. And we must remember that these discussions are not philosophical. The argument of whether Gentiles need to be circumcised to be brought into the community and have table fellowship with the church is deeply practical. So, what are some of the misconceptions that arise? And why does Paul insist that circumcision no longer matters for membership in God's community? First, when Paul is speaking about the gospel, he is not speaking about inner feelings versus outward action. In other words, he isn't saying that it used to be about outward things that you did, such as circumcision and following the law and religious practices and liturgy, but now it's simply about how you feel. Wright points out this important distinction in this way. In this climate of thought, it has been easy for us to imagine, wrongly, that we have understood why Paul was insisting that circumcision no longer mattered for membership in God's community. Obviously, we think, he was interested in a person's inner reality, over against those fussy legalists who thought you had to obey a string of ritual instructions. He believed, we say, in a message of love rather than law, of inward feeling rather than outward conformity, of faith in the heart rather than rule book religion or liturgical performance. In particular, we suppose, Paul believed that God didn't require a perfect moral obedience from people because God, in any case, always preferred right feelings, including faith, to right actions, which make you proud. And so we could go on. As Wright's satire shows, what's important here is that Paul is not proclaiming that Jesus has abolished the law or the practices and guidelines given in the scriptures. Paul isn't condemning the motivation to follow God's rules, obey the mandate of circumcision, poking at the ritual instructions, or calling the conformity present in the day old-fashioned or backwards thinking. Again, he is not preaching a gospel of tolerance, as if the point of Jesus' life was to tell everyone to loosen up and not take everything so seriously. See, all of this should help us understand what grace means. See, Paul is not saying that Jesus has come and changed things and thrown out and made the rules more lenient. But instead, Paul is proclaiming that through Jesus, we have been brought into right relation with God. This is the message of grace. And the church in Jerusalem also understood this teaching of grace, that God had accomplished all things through Jesus, and that through this Messiah, we are now welcomed into God's family. In other words, Paul agrees, and in fact is the primary proponent of what we believe as Lutherans, about us being justified before God because of Christ's death for our sins and resurrection, where he defeats death and the devil. We believe that we are brought into the family of believers, into the covenantal relationship, because of what he has done and not because of what we have done. But that being said, we have to make sure that we don't turn this message of grace into something it's not. It's not a new message that the law given by God doesn't matter. It's not a message that the old Jewish guidelines were wrong. And once again, we are certainly not saying that Jesus and Paul's message was just one of tolerance where everything now goes and the old law is somehow abolished. So, with the groundwork now being set, we see four historical things happen very quickly. First, the church in Jerusalem sends Peter out to investigate what is happening in Antioch, where Paul is. At first, Peter is pleased at what he sees, and he takes part in the church's life, consisting of Jews and uncircumcised Gentiles. Second, later, some others come from Jerusalem who at least claim to be sent by James. This group of people caused the controversies that ensue. Third, Paul receives news that a similar group of people were sent to the churches in Galatia, where Paul had just left, and had been teaching that non-Jews had to be circumcised or they couldn't be welcomed into the Christian community. And fourth, all of this leads to Paul's writing of Galatians. Again, at first, Peter supports everything that Paul is doing. But after the group comes claiming to be from James, Peter changes his tone and begins to support mandatory circumcision. Again, it's important to note that even Barnabas was carried along by their sham and supports the circumcision party. Their belief that if the Gentiles had really left their allegiance with the darkness prevalent in the pagan communities, if they were allowed into the covenant relationship with God to inherit God's new creation, then they would have to exhibit covenant loyalty. And this included primarily circumcision. However, Paul adamantly disagrees. And seeing why, misconceptions aside, puts on the forefront of our mind what shapes Paul's Christian life, his proclamation of the gospel, and his understanding of who Jesus is and what the church is called to believe. Wright describes Paul's viewpoint in this way. Paul had come to believe that Jesus couldn't simply be added to the earlier picture of God's rescuing kingdom. The shocking and unexpected events of the Messiah's death and resurrection, coupled with the dramatic sense of personal renewal, for which the only explanation was the outpoured divine spirit, meant that everything had changed. A new world had been launched, and if people were trying to live in that new world while wanting at the same time to put on a good face before people who hadn't realized just how radical this new world was, they were precisely putting on a face, playing a part, covering up reality with a mask. They were, in short, play-acting. The Greek word for play-acting is hypokrisis, which we get the English term hypocrisy. Paul later recounts in Galatians how he stood up to Peter on this issue. And amazingly, Peter submits to Paul, agreeing that Paul was correct. And the key to why Peter agrees is because Paul is stating that Jesus fulfilled the purpose of Israel and the purpose of God's rescue mission. This meant that people were brought into the kingdom by believing and being loyal to the one true God. And this was done by one's identity in Jesus Christ. This meant that forcing people to adhere to the old covenant was overlooking the importance of Jesus' death and resurrection. Paul is stating that the mandate given to Israel, especially circumcision, were rightly established to help Israel until their Messiah would arrive. This is why Paul says to Peter, as recorded in Galatians 2, "We are Jews by birth, not Gentile sinners, but we know that a person is not declared righteous by works of the Jewish law, but through the faithfulness of Jesus the Messiah." See, for Paul here, he is dealing with the practical issue of having full fellowship with Gentile believers. And his point is that all now have a right relationship with God, not by returning to the regulations set up with Moses and Abraham, but by now loyally committing and having faith in Jesus as Lord. Now here again, we meet that word pistis, or faith as we translate it, which we discussed in a previous video. Wright outlines what this strong word means for Paul in this way. The point is that in a world where the key thing for a zealous Jew was loyalty to God and his law, Paul believed, one, that Jesus the Messiah had been utterly faithful to the divine purpose, obedient even to the death of the cross, as he says elsewhere. Two, that following Jesus, whatever it took, had to be seen as itself a central expression of loyalty to Israel's God. Three, that the followers of Jesus were themselves marked out by their belief in him, confessing him as Lord and believing that he was raised from the dead. And four, if this Jesus-shaped loyalty was the vital thing, then nothing that the law could say was to come between one Jesus follower and another. All of this is leading to a radical message of unity. Unity that for Paul can only be found in the person of Jesus Christ. In our next section, we will bring all of this to a conclusion. But I want to quickly mention that everything we are here discussing sets the stage for the book of Galatians. This standoff between Paul and Peter, and especially with those who taught the need for circumcision in the Galatian churches, is what prompts Paul's writing of Galatians. However, we aren't going to unpack that letter now. After the study is complete on Paul's life, we will return for a 1-2 video summary of the context for each letter that Paul writes, so that at that time, we will return and dive a little bit deeper into Paul's particular writing regarding this dispute. We've covered a lot today, so let's summarize our discussion thus far and then draw out some practical applications for our own Christian life and community. First, there is a debate between the church in Jerusalem, with James being the leader, although we aren't positive that the messengers actually did come from James, and with Paul. All agree that Jesus is Lord and that he has established the new kingdom, which is for both Jews and Gentiles. However, the question is, what do the Gentiles need to do to be grafted in? Circumcision is at the forefront of this disagreement. Paul is the one who stands up and says that the Gentiles don't need to be circumcised. He ends up winning this argument, and the key is his understanding of what it means that Jesus is the Messiah who carries out God's rescue plan. His argument is very practical, because the church in Jerusalem was stating that Gentiles, unless they submit to circumcision, cannot have table fellowship with the Jews and participate fully in the life of the church. Paul argues that it is not about circumcision, but instead about loyal confession that Jesus is Lord. And as long as someone does this, then they don't need to be circumcised. Now, let's add one more detail that should drive this home. Paul pointed out at the end of Deuteronomy, which is the end of the Torah in the Old Testament, that Moses prophesied that the Israelites would reject God and his covenant. This meant that the law of the Torah was even a stumbling block for the Jew because even they could not live up to it. For Paul, this showed that even the law of Moses anticipated something better to come. It wasn't the end, but something that prepared for the end. Jew and Gentile alike needed saving. For Paul, this showed how the old covenant, though good in itself, could not be the end game. The old covenant, with the law and everything included in it, awaited something that would come and fulfill it. This is what Jesus the Messiah had done. By following the law perfectly, he fulfilled, not abolished, the law. This meant that the new kingdom which he launched couldn't possibly demand its members to submit and return to something old. This meant that circumcision and the dietary laws, all the things that were established to set the Israelites apart, no longer were necessary. And all of this leads to the practical implication that there's not a two-tiered Christian community. Jesus didn't die so that his church would have an inner group and then an outer group. The miraculous accomplishment was that Jesus had called both Jew and Gentile together in his new kingdom to live as one. This amazingly fulfilled the covenantal promises made to Abraham long ago, that through his offspring the world would be saved and that they would all be one family. Wright pieces this all together for us here. In other words, if Peter, and by implication, those who have come from James, try to reestablish a two-tier Jesus movement, with Jews at one table and Gentiles at another, all they are doing is declaring that the movement of God's sovereign love, reaching out to the utterly undeserving, grace, in other words, was actually irrelevant. God need not have bothered. If the Torah, the five books of Moses, was sufficient for all time to define the people of God, then there is no need for a crucified Messiah. Or to put it the other way, if God has declared in the resurrection that the crucified Jesus really was and is the Messiah, then God is also declaring that Moses could only take them so far. He pointed to a promised land, an inheritance, but could not himself take the people into it. Galatians is all about the ultimate inheritance that God had promised. And as we shall see presently, Paul insisted that the heirs of this inheritance could not be defined by the Torah, but only by the Messiah himself, the ultimate heir. Once again, the focus is that Jesus is the one who has fulfilled the Old Testament and established a new community and a new kingdom in his name. One that both Jew and Gentile desperately needed. One that brought unity. One that worshiped the one true God and him alone. One that welcomed all in, that would submit and be loyal and have faith in Christ. That said, all who were welcomed in were still called to abandon old moral and false worship practices. Paul was adamant that Gentiles brought in had to radically change their understanding of morality, sexuality, their worship of false idols, and their involvement in the pagan worship prevalent in the society around them. In conclusion, Paul's vision was one of unity, but not unity for the sake of unity. Certainly not unity by becoming lax and lenient towards God's word and his law. Certainly not a new religion of tolerance and live and let live. But unity in a communal and loyal worship to the one true God through his Messiah and Son, Jesus Christ, who fulfilled the Old Testament law and the Israelite nation and was now launching the final part of God's salvation plan. One unified kingdom under Jesus Christ, forgiven and renewed by him, and called to live out his love in the world. And Paul made this very case in Jerusalem. And with Peter's support, the church in Jerusalem supported Paul and approved that Christians were not defined by circumcision, but by loyal faith to Christ Jesus. This brings this chapter to a close. Thank you for joining us today. I hope you and your family are doing well. And I welcome you back on Thursday to join us as we watch Paul and his visit to Athens. Take care. God bless.